This show's just gonna like turn into Hate Watch. We just open packages.
Okay.
Yeah, Ben had a kid. We immediately stopped trying.
We
lose all chemistry.
Just
as
turns
friends.
Into a flop house. We all just start getting fucked up. Ben's like trying to reel us in.
Yeah, you and me are crushing up like benzos, snorting them off the Patrice framed poster.
Well, now that we have a P.O. box, we can become like an unwrapping channel.
That's
we
true.
We make millions of dollars for like toddlers and babies.
Yeah. Yeah. And we just go like, oh, look, it's a bomb.
One of those YouTube channels where it's for kids and pedophiles at the same time. Mm-hmm. Are we recording now?
Yeah.
It's good by now, right?
It's red. Yeah, we should be good.
Can we? So we started a P.O. box and we've got, I think, my favorite piece of fan mail. I picked this up this week. So just read that out loud for the camera, Ben.
Oh, and the P.O. box is public.
Yeah, we'll post that in the episode description.
That's all it is?
That's all it is.
It's Rob Schneider as
a Chinese man, and I now pronounce you Chuck and Larry.
Hell yeah.
I opened that in the post office.
They have no ink. They printed it like a fast
You open
draft.
It up at...
I was in front of an old black woman getting the rest of the P.O. box, and I was opening stuff, and I just unwrapped a Chinese guy. And I go, very good.
Oh,
and
then look at you with your little ching chong bing bong fan art.
Oh, is this one of them racist podcast P.O. boxes?
Oh, we get a lot of y'all here.
We get a lot of y'all shit.
I guess to protect people's privacy, I can't say
their
name, right?
Read their address.
They have like jobs, right?
I doubt it.
I don't know.
Jobs.
They're allowed inside post offices.
They're on disability.
Mm-hmm.
These people are still waiting for their $1,200 stimulus check.
No, it's been very, because this week I've been emailing people who. Yeah, there you go.
Someone sent me Anthony Cabilla's memoir.
Mm-hmm. Oh my God. Yeah. Wait, he wrote a book?
Mm-hmm. I guess. I didn't know that.
It's the only book with an N-word and a foreword. Now I've been emailing people who put their addresses in wrong this week, and it's been really fun because I've been shooting out emails like, "Hey, you gave me this address," and they go, "Ah, damn, that doesn't exist. Sorry, I was blackout drunk."
Where do these? How does that happen? By the way, how did we get so many people that don't know where they live?
So then this guy says how much he appreciates and loves the show, and he goes, "Also, here's an Anthony Cumia tweet from earlier today," and then he posts a screenshot of a tweet he printed out from Anthony Cumia.
Which is really how you should read Anthony's tweets.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, and it's him being mad about George Floyd. Mm. He says, in response to Biden saying, "I urge Congress to pass the George Floyd Justice and Policing Act," blah blah blah, and Anthony Cumia quote tweeted it and say, "They name a bill after a violent drug addicted piece of shit." Stop canonizing this low-life corpse.
God.
How these people get a single vote in this country is beyond me.
God. I'm glad I didn't open that in front of the black lady.
Wow.
And then he signed it.
Signed it.
Well, the guy who sent the letter signed it.
Yeah, Esquire.
With happy holidays.
Thank Man.
That's that. From Christopher Arnold.
Yeah.
These are great. I'm actually going to read this.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sure it's great.
Do you think like Richard Spencer like frames like Cumia tweets like when Jay-Z shouted out Mac Miller and Jay-Z like he like put a placard of the tweet?
Yeah, I think he has it in like embossed in metal. Like it's like a fucking those posters we sell.
Patrice O'Neill once said, he could access funny quicker. There's also a whole thing when I skimmed through it for a
Patrice
second.
Patrice said he could access funny quicker than anybody else that he met.
Which goes to show the duality of man, you know, to want to round up all black people and put them in camps and kill them. What and to also be really, really funny.
What if he became too funny that's the reason he became racist? They like overloaded. Like in The Matrix, when Neo gets too much of The Matrix and he becomes like magic, it's like that type of thing.
Yeah, I think so. I mean,
he channeled too much. When he did the Popeye getting crucified bit, it was too much comedy and it made him racist in the blink of an eye. Like the lawnmower man for N-words.
Honestly, like if you go on like Splash Mountain, you should turn and just see Anthony Cumia like chasing a little black figure.
Yeah, tied up in like a briar bush. Yeah. He's been tricked into a big thorny bush. Trying to take pictures of a Briar Rabbit on his cell phone.
This sent me this.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
It's just the Bert Kreischer's first comedy
Comfortably
special.
Comfortably dumb.
Yeah.
He looks good there.
Yep.
He looks a little healthier there.
So it's in the package. It's see what's in the box.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's ticking.
This is nice. They actually like wrapped it so it wouldn't break, whatever it is.
Yeah.
Oh, they, it's different gifts. For, this says to Devin from Hitler.
Yeah. So this is from, lovely. So Hitler's son is a fan of the show. And sent us in a bunch of stuff.
It's kind of I feel like it's like literally a turd. I feel like I just shit in a.
Oh, this is to Devin from Hans Kim.
Oh. Oh,
so,
this is.
So it actually is a bomb.
Oh, this says to Ben from Red Band. Very
okay,
good.
Okay, very good. If there's nothing for me, I'm going to kill myself live on air.
Which makes it even funnier.
Damn, that sucks. Oh, wait, no, I think he did get me something. I think I took it out and forgot to open it. And I'm not making that up.
It's like a Blue Lives Matter gun shirt. What doesn't kill me makes me fucking stronger.
Makes me, whatever doesn't kill me better start fucking running. That's pretty good.
Hell yeah. I'll wear that at the gym.
Yeah, imagine we get on Rogan and you wear that shirt. And we just talk about that for 90 minutes.
I wear that shirt and he goes, "You're the funniest guy I've ever met."
Yeah, he's like, "No, you can put like messages on a shirt about how much of a badass you are."
You know about that, man?
I fought for whiskey, bacon, and freedom. Man, I'm glad I didn't get one now, honestly.
What the hell is this thing?
And Devin got two. This is going to be a human bone. It's going to be like his grandma's finger.
I love that we have a P.O. box. It's expensive to have a P.O. box, but it's worth it.
Well, there's a little note in here, and it says it's the extra muscle they have.
Are you serious?
And he cut it out of a black guy doing an experiment.
God bless these people.
Why is
God,
it so wrapped?
God bless us, everyone.
Okay, who's going to get to read the Anthony Kamiya memoir first?
Oh, it's a bottle opener. Thank you.
It looks vaguely racist, though.
Oh, it's like a big, it's like a fish, a big mouse Billy Bass. Hell yeah, thank you, buddy. Whatever. Appreciate you.
Nice.
Fuck this place.
Yeah, so that was that was nice. Ben's wife has shit a baby out too, so got a new dad.
Congratulations! Thank How do you feel? Is it different? Do you feel any different?
You can't. I mean, obviously, like you can't like now imagine like life without her, but like nothing's really changed for me.
Gotcha. Mm. Okay.
Like, can I tell you something? And but only if you guys promise not to be mad.
Sure.
I did end up watching that George Floyd documentary. Over the holidays.
Wait, what is this one?
The one on YouTube, the George Floyd documentary, oh, it's the YouTube's, Fall of Minneapolis.
Yeah, so it's not a good documentary.
Oh, so it's like about YouTube. How he wasn't really killed.
Yeah, yeah.
It was
yeah.
directed by a knee. A knee that was tired of bad press. Mm,
yeah, produced by Barbara Shears.
Yeah, so nothing's really changed for me. I mean,
yeah,
I've just been preparing myself for it. Because you look at her and you go... I mean, one day I'm going to have to answer, you know, she's going to have to ask me questions and I'm going to have answers. Like, you know, she's going to look up at me and be like, daddy, why was there 11 nanograms of fentanyl in George Floyd's blood system? And I'll go, well, I don't know.
Mm-hmm. These are the questions.
You're going to sit her down and be like, so you've heard of the birds and the bees. What happens is the bird goes into the bee's store and he's high on fent. He starts bugging out.
I've told I watched the documentary has been very upset with me.
Who do you tell?
Just my friends. Like I'll be like, I watch, and they're like, stop.
Please don't do that. Yeah,
because I knew going into it too. Any documentary I watched before, I think I said I know I'm gonna believe whatever it says. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, you're just downloading a new person out. You go in a thing and come out, and I believe whatever the documentary said.
It's also funny to imagine the picture because I've seen your living room. It's a beautiful Christmas tree. It's like you're holding a beautiful baby. You're next to a pillow that says like "Home is where the dogs are," and then the TV is like, "Would a black man choke to death in 8 minutes?"
Well, it's funny because I have my newborn here, and I'm like burping her, and I have my laptop on my knee, and then the documentary is on the TV.
Yeah. You're screencasting it?
I have the computer because I'm downloading like the PDF of his toxicology report from the Minneapolis Medical Examiner's like website and stuff. Mm-hmm. Like I'm fact checking everything.
You're one of those shitty dads who like puts his phone on his kid's head to watch football, but it's just for crime statistics.
I will say this because enough time has passed that it's worn off on me a little bit. I will say this: the man did not get a fair trial. I think that's Chauvin. Fair. I think that's fair. He didn't get a fair trial.
Mm. Yeah.
Here's a couple big things.
Sure.
That I'd like to. Wait,
it is funny to be taught. It is funny to say this, and I keep looking. I go, there's Shaq bobblehead. That's Kobe Bryant. That's a bunch of black people. There's Patrice. Mm-hmm.
And there's the Anthony Kiedis. Like, yeah. By the way, can
well,
I
truly,
see
truly, our heroes are either black people or people who hate black people.
And this book cover is like, it's funny to him. He's like, isn't it funny a white guy in prison?
Yeah.
He's like, don't you get it?
Because you've never seen this before.
Yeah. And I do love Ant, but that is basically the caution tape over the mouth. Like
it is.
Headshot.
It's the comedy special holding the mic up to your head like a gun.
Like a gun. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It is amazing. He got a career doing blackface.
Yeah, that was his big break. Was he did
Electroshock OJ?
Yeah, to the tune that of Sim on the Dock of the Bay.
Well, he hates black people because he hates himself. He's like a swarthy
that's
Sicilian.
True.
You know, mm-hmm. the whole fucking yeah. True Romance speech is all about Anthony.
Oh, you know, he saw. You know, he saw that scene and just started going ape shit in the theater, throwing sodas, shooting at the screen.
Oh, they had to like restrain him, mm-hmm. probably in the aisle. Mm-hmm. Someone had to put a knee on his neck. Which, so that's one of the things is what's very funny is Derek Chauvin's mom, mm. like her, his like mommy is in the documentary.
What is her name?
I don't know.
Martha Chauvin?
Yeah, it's something like, it just at the bottom, it says like Derek Chauvin's mommy or whatever.
Mommy.
And she's just like, she's like this big Kathy Bates like type lady. It's very mm-hmm. funny. She's just like, my baby did nothing wrong. Mm-hmm. Like all that shit, you know? Mm-hmm. But
he has soft knees. My baby's yeah. knees are like pillows.
She found a rider that drove off the road and takes him in and just kneels on his neck.
Yeah, breaks his knees by kneeling on them, putting a wood block and kneeling into them.
So this was one of the biggest things to me is she kept holding up Derek Chauvin's police manual where she's like, this is my son's manual right here that the judge kept rejecting. Judge Cahill, I think his name was, kept rejecting it as evidence, which clearly states in the Minneapolis police manual, training manual, that MRT is the way you restrain people who refuse to be arrested.
What is MRT?
Maximum restraint, right. Whatever.
Must really terminate black people. That's what we call MRT.
MRTB, that's Kanye's new album.
So in the manual, it shows a picture of a guy kneeling on someone's neck.
Mm.
Mm. And they keep asking the police chiefs on the stand, like, do you train any of your officers to do this? They're like, no, not at all. Mm-hmm. And then they tried to submit the training manual for evidence, and the judge struck it down.
Right.
He said it couldn't be evidence.
Which is, I mean, it is a funny defense. Like, Your Honor, if my son was racist, would he do something the police would do? Sorry, not to be yeah. a cuck. Sorry, I'm a cuck.
No, she's like, here's my son's a training manual right here. And she holds up a DVD copy of American History X. She's like, everything, they make them watch this thousands of times.
No. My son's boss was David Duke. But he did nothing wrong.
Could have taken him out to the curb. We're lucky it was just a knee.
He was eyeing that curb right next to him the whole time.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they call curbs black people dentists.
Dude, I met somebody who's curb stomped recently.
What?
Not like recently, but I met a guy recently who was curb stomped in San Diego, like one of my friend's friends.
Oh my God.
Got like four teeth missing on the front of his...
What is he up to? Why is he around people that curb stomp as a punishment?
I know. I shook his hand and he just started shaking like a dog that only gets beat by men.
Yeah. I didn't even know you could survive that.
Me neither.
Yeah. No, I mean, he got fucked up, but it was like 10 years ago, but he's got all his like fucking teeth missing. God. He was Mexican. He got curb stomped. Can you imagine getting curb stomped for being Mexican?
It was like a race thing?
Yeah, it was a race thing.
It was a hate crime.
Yeah,
really?
Yeah, yeah. It was Chaco Willing curb stomped him. He got too close to the seal beach where they spray water on him.
The curb stomping thing is crazy because it turns your face into, remember in Beetlejuice when she opens up her jaw really wide? Mm-hmm. It's crazy because it just splits you like a jawbreaker.
Yeah, I think the guy didn't do it great because I don't think it broke his jaw open, but it did like fucking
fuck
knock
his
all
out.
His teeth out. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He was wearing like Hokas. Yeah. It was like too much cushion.
Yeah, he had to do the pump real quick. But no, he runs a very high end sushi restaurant now. Curb stomp victim, sushi guy.
Okay.
So
Mexican? That
makes Mexican
sushi?
Guy, yeah. I mean, it's a lot. It's a, you know, it's a walking race joke.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
Anyway.
He's just making ceviche. He calls it a sushi place.
That's just shrimp taco.
It's a shrimp and tomato sauce, Juan. Okay. We're not at Nobu.
So anyway, you were saying, Ben, what was the other point that they defended him with?
He got arrested like a year before that too, and there's video of him as he's getting arrested. He's throwing all these pills in his mouth, and it's a bunch of fentanyl.
George Floyd.
Yeah, and then he admits, he's like, "Yeah, I just threw all these pills in my mouth."
Imagine taking fentanyl.
Was he trying to kill himself?
No, he's trying to hide it so he doesn't get arrested. And his tolerance for fentanyl is higher.
That's an interesting strategy.
And then he admits it.
Yeah, that's an interesting.
He calls his mouth the toilet. That's like, I'm flushing it.
Juice WRLD did that. Juice WRLD literally was like, "Yo, my friends are gonna get in trouble, so I should eat all of these drugs and die."
Yeah, he's like, "I should take 800 pills of fentanyl lace in it."
I mean, I could. So here's the thing: they did an independent autopsy report that was separate from the medical examiner of the county. Then George Floyd's family and the defense, the prosecutor. The family hired someone else that said, like, none of this had anything to do with him not being able to breathe. Mm. And then on live on TV with the trial, they're like, "No, we don't train anybody to kneel on people's necks." Yeah. Even though there's literally diagrams that are exactly like how Chauvin's doing it.
Right.
Right.
Where you pin someone's neck down so they stop moving. Because he started kicking all the cops. I'd seen the video, actually.
Never see the back. It's the cars blocking it.
Yeah.
My favorite's the Asian guy that just watches. He's like, "Shame to your mother."
The Asian guy, he got a couple years, too.
Yeah, he put hands behind back at one point.
Yeah.
Yeah, just started staring at him.
He started gliding. He took a walk. He took a brisk walk. He started exercising.
He's like, "Choke him until the cigarette goes down to the nub." It would be funny if just below the car, you don't see he has just two guns he's firing the whole time.
So it wasn't the amount of fentanyl, though, in his system, not really, like, it's in back pain pills, that amount, kind of.
According to the separate medical examiner that they did with the autopsy, they decided it had nothing to do with anything.
The pills.
Yeah,
the fentanyl did not kill him?
Yeah, so this is the...
Weird.
I mean, I'm just saying. Like,
it's as if we watched a video of a guy for 9 minutes.
Of a man being murdered. Weird.
So I want to say it looks worse than, because first of all, number 7's caffeine positive. It's like, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Number 6 is codeine positive. I looked that up. You know what that is?
It's codeine.
No,
right?
it's tobacco.
Oh.
Oh, what?
Like he was just smoking cigarettes.
So he had a cigarette that day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, or a Zen, possibly. But he had respiratory issues.
We know George Floyd was definitely popping Zens.
And he had a hyper, what's it called? A hyper, where your blood can't pump properly and stuff.
High
hyper
blood pressure?
Fuck.
Whatever.
I'm retarded.
I mean, he had the same like blood test as like Henry Hill at the end. He was just having Henry Hill's last day.
He had hypertensive heart disease.
Mm. Okay.
Cardiomegaly.
Right.
He got the vaccine would have killed this guy immediately.
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, he wasn't healthy. I mean, whatever, but...
He was jacked, though, somehow. He looked good.
Yeah, but that's...
I had George Floyd's
shit. There's a lot of black people out there that, like, are very athletic looking, and they drop dead at 50.
Yeah, exactly. They have, like, John Henry disease.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's really like a curse from God, frankly. Mm.
Yeah. So apparently this can facilitate some sort of response where he can't really breathe very well and it suppresses the lungs.
Right.
And then he keeps kicking and he's refusing to get in the car. Mm. And then some guy walks by and he goes, "Jesus, dude, you're going to give yourself a heart attack. Just get in."
Oh, a guy says that?
A civilian walking by says that.
Anthony Kamea walked by.
Yeah. Opie tried to step on his neck like a cake.
So then he keeps kicking them all, and then they take him out and put him on the ground, and then he does the MRT thing, which he's trained to do, where he kneels on someone's neck without cutting off the airflow, supposedly.
Mm.
That's what's crazy to me is I always thought he goes, "This is how I do things around here, Buster."
Right. Right.
I just put my foot on their fucking
Well, that's
neck.
What I thought too. He's like, I'm a bit of a John Wayne. Mm-hmm. Like I go buck wild.
Yeah. So everybody in the trial was trying to save their own ass and was afraid that they would be, because these people, the cops probably felt like, and let me relate this to you guys so you can understand it. They probably felt like the good people in Killers of the Flower Moon, where they go, mm-hmm. this town is going to hunt me mm-hmm. for the rest of my mm-hmm. life yeah. if I don't go up yeah, on the stand.
This knee's just going to slow him down.
Now the Air Force is on the other foot.
So the police chiefs, everybody goes up. They go, we don't train anybody. Dude, that's crazy. We all threw them under the bus.
We tell them to let black people go historically. We don't have a history of this.
I will say this, whether or not, you know, Chauvin is it's negligence or he wanted to, you know, take another man's life. I don't know that, but I do know he did not receive a fair trial, which he has a right to in this country.
Well, either did O'Reilly's Auto Parts. I mean, they didn't kill anybody, and a lot of those were burned down.
And by the way, it's funny. All of a sudden, I care about justice.
Yeah. It is hilarious. This is amazing.
I'm like, Your Honor. Yeah.
I was literally going to say, the second you had a daughter, you started becoming a George Floyd guy.
So for real. 4 years later,
I'm Floyd-pilled, though.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you are Floyd-pilled.
Was there anything about, like, wasn't there a whole thing when all that was happening where they said they, like, kind of knew each other and they used to be bouncers at a club?
They worked at a nightclub together.
And I think there was, like, some personal vendetta. Like, it wasn't, like, Chauvin kind of, like, angry at George?
Well, I'm watching a documentary that says Derek Chauvin's innocent. So they probably
they don't get into any of that. Well, because they can't have a part where, like, he was friends with a black guy in it. God forbid.
By the way, if you pause the video of the officers arresting him, his mouth is open and it looks like there's pills in it. Like he had popped them again right there.
Mm-hmm.
And by the way, 11 nanograms of fentanyl is not nothing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, it could have been jewels from his teeth.
Oh, yeah. I'm not saying he was a pinnacle of health and wasn't, you know, up to some stuff.
Yeah.
Guy was yelling, I can't breathe, and then did die. So, you know, unfortunately, that video doesn't look great for you, pal. Yeah. I don't know what to tell you.
And it is,
who gives a shit about the science behind it, honestly?
And it is like not to be a woke cuck, but a little bit of that argument is like, guys, come on. He was really fucking black. Like, that's kind of the real argument.
That is kind of what they're saying. They're like, he was big and black and strong and can't take a little white knee.
He tested positive for dunking, your officer.
So this study I read just because I'm like, what did actually happen? Because this changed America completely. It's changed everything. Mm-hmm. This and January 6th really impacted the culture.
It helped ruin TV, frankly. Yeah.
Well, you know, George Floyd would have been really into Ashley Babbitt. He would have fucked the shit out of her. They would have been married today. Had they both lived.
Okay, so I will say this. So, like, when people say...
I will say this. This is so funny you had a kid.
There's no
like
way.
I'm literally imagining...
I haven't seen you since you had your firstborn baby.
I know. I'm literally imagining he sees his baby for the first time in me. He's like, we gotta get him off the streets. They're fucking animals.
This was the 8 accidental drug overdose deaths in which fentanyl was deemed solely responsible. Of these, the mean blood concentration was 36 nanograms per milliliter, range of 5 to 120. So that means someone overdosed at 5 and someone overdosed at 120. So he had a lethal dose of fentanyl in him. So if anybody ever says, the examiner said if he was found alone in his apartment and they did the toxicology report, they would deem it an overdose most likely.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But then they'd be like, hey, did any of your roommates like kneel on your neck for 9 minutes before we got here? Yeah,
we think a knee broke in and killed him.
I think my personal theory on it is that his lungs were having a lot of trouble breathing to the point where you could literally just put your hand on his neck, probably like this, and cut off any airflow.
I'm willing to say he wasn't a normal guy having his neck stepped on.
Yeah,
but
it wasn't like he was Reginald Van Johnson getting choked out.
And he also did say, I can't breathe, maybe take the knee off a little bit.
And I think that was true, he couldn't breathe, but he kept kicking. He kept kicking like crazy. And like, when I have a newborn and it's hard when you're putting the onesie on. Right. And she's
when
fidgeting.
You change your diaper, you put the knee on her.
Yeah.
Just to get her secure.
It's MRT. It's in my manual. I kneel on my newborn to put her diaper
and
on.
You go, stop resisting. Stop resisting.
You put a police uniform on the umbilical cord when she was in the womb. It got her wrapped around her neck a few times.
You go through her shin, you're like, fentanyl, just like I expected. That's a fentanyl pill casing.
But I got to say, having a daughter was the most beautiful experience I've ever had in my life.
I know. You really have taken to it very well. It's been very fun to watch.
Yeah, everybody's really proud of me, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You did great.
Everyone says I'm like killing it.
You came like 10 months ago and you've done so much work since then.
It was such a, God, I wish I want to tell everybody to have a kid.
Mm.
It's such a beautiful,
but you
shouldn't have a kid unless, you know, you love your partner and you have your shit together. Mm-hmm. Like you have to like get your soul right with God before you.
Right. But by the way, when he says that, that's not for anybody who listens to this show at all. Should not have a
kid. Don't have any children.
Yeah.
It's changed everything.
Yeah.
I held her in my arms on Christmas Day and I watched It's a Wonderful Life with her, and it was maybe the most favorite thing. It was the best experience I've ever had in my life. Yeah. I just held her and watched It's a Wonderful Life.
Dude, can I tell you, I watched It's a Wonderful Life on Christmas Day. I almost started crying just thinking about all the blessings.
It's one of the greatest films ever made.
It's true. It's truly one of the greatest American films of all
time.
It's
so good.
Yeah.
I do love the...
More of a click guy.
Have you seen Santa Claus 2?
Christmas with the Cranks. Hello.
There is like a bunch of like veiled racism in it, though.
Yeah, that's why I said the greatest film of all time. Well, George, you can't kill yourself. You're Donald O'Meara, a black guy.
George Floyd Bailey.
Well, our fentanyl's not in my system. It's your near system and your system over there. And Mrs. Johnson's cat. They've all got fentanyl. Yeah.
That's very good.
The whole town comes together and gives him $18. He's just trying to get one parking ticket paid for in the city of fucking Crenshaw.
What's funny is he's like, he like dies.
An angel gets his lemon pepper wings. Okay. Woo! We still got it. We still got it, guys.
It's funny because of the movie, he wishes he was never born. And then Clarence, the angel, grants him the wish at the end of for the last 10 minutes of the movie.
It happens so late in the movie.
So late.
Yeah.
How you remember it is it happens immediately.
It happens in the last 20 minutes of the movie.
Oh, it's great. And then he's running through the town. And he's figuring out he actually was never born. And like as he's going through the town's like a black, like they're listening to like black music.
No, literally, yeah.
And there's like crazy lights going, and everybody's a whore.
He runs back into town, and there's like a pickup game going on. He's like, oh my god, it's horrible. Dude, there's also the funniest scene because he like goes back. He's like, oh, yeah, your brother died in the ice when he was a little boy, and you
weren't there to save him because you were never born, George.
Yeah, you were never born. And your wife, she's just an ugly bitch. She works at the library. She's just an ugly, lonely bitch.
She works at the library and she like never fucked.
Yeah.
That's the whole thing.
And that's the one part that truly terrifies him. He sees his wife and she just has glasses and a hat.
Dude,
and
he flips out. He flips out. He tracks her down and he chases her into a bar and he starts trying to like fucking rape her.
Yeah.
He like holds her down and shit. Like, people pull him off.
No, he goes, Mary, suck me off, Mary. Mary, you gotta make. I gotta come in you.
She saw her hymen attacked. It's not right.
Come here. Yeah, who fucked you? Who fucked you? You whore, man. Yeah, he's just mad because other people fucked her because he was never born. Mm-hmm. Did you fuck Martini? That Italian guy at the bar.
The end. The whole town comes together to give him money, and then the one like black lady comes in. She's like, "Oh shit, I got money for you too, honey." Chad, like, what is this? It's the last 30 seconds,
dude.
Of
literally,
the movie.
And everybody comes in. They go, "And Merry Christmas to George Bailey, the greatest man who ever lived." Here's $5,000, and then I swear to God, a black lady, big head goes, "Oh my God, Bailey, he had a quarter for you.
I ain't got no money, but I got some Fred Watermill for you."
Dude, I swear to God,
it's crazy.
Everybody laughs at her, and she might get pushed down and kneed at the party.
No, so that's what's funny. Everybody's laughing because it's like, oh, even a black person is chipping in to help out old George Bailey.
Old George Bailey.
Yeah. It's a fantastic
It's film. His maid. I haven't seen that movie.
Oh, no,
in
it was his maid.
It was
the, his, I think his father's maid, Mr. Bailey's housekeeper. But anyway,
yeah,
it's fantastic. It's literally like one of the greatest films I've ever seen.
Then you got a beautiful. I mean, your kid being born like a few days before Christmas is like such a weird, lovely time.
It was
like,
amazing.
Bunch of things coming together.
And then right after that, I literally put on the George Floyd documentary. And I told my wife to go. I'm like, go run some errands. Yeah, I have some research to do for work.
As Katie's bleeding like a slug behind her. You're like, hey, get some pizzas.
I hand her $20.
Yeah,
I gotta go get a pedicure.
I gotta do research for the podcast we're recording in 10 days. No, it was great. I went to the hospital and I got the I got to hold her. She farted in my hands immediately. It was beautiful. She looks like the little she looks like the alien from Men in Black, the little squid alien when she was first
when she
born.
Was like in the first.
Oh
few
yeah,
hours.
The really yeah. cute.
Because she got the shit beat out of her, and she's got these giant
nine pounds,
yeah.
5 hours of labor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's crazy.
Women are incredible. I would have tapped out immediately.
Oh yeah,
I would have. I'd be like, nope, not doing this. Shit.
I would be like, yeah. Kill this kid, get this out of me. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
she's also, I gotta say, very ethnic looking. To
I was gonna, I didn't want to say, but okay. You got a little brown baby,
very tan.
You sent a picture beautiful. Of her. You sent a picture of her in a purple bow, and I thought it was Maya Angelou for a second.
Yeah.
I thought she was going to read me poetry at a liberal arts college.
This is God's revenge on me. He's like, I'm going to give you a beautiful baby right. that's vaguely mixed race, yeah. and you'll always wonder.
But the baby is the baby wonder. Is yours, but it is very black. A very black baby. With your blood. It's your blood. But it looks like Rachel Dolezal.
Yeah, the baby looks like it was born to Bentavious Caldwell Pope.
That's so funny. I come in the room, she's already palming a basketball. So what's weird is we had like this weird Eastern European nurse, and the hospital's a shithole. The lights don't work. The guy's putting the epidural in my wife's spine in the dark. He's like, this is very dangerous.
Yeah, the lights went out while they were giving the epidural.
Yeah, what you kept talking about that. I'm like, what hospital is this? Where like, it sounds like what was Katrina happening? And like the electricity kept going off yeah. and on.
You went to Chauvin Memorial. He went to Ben Shapiro's crowdfunded yeah. hospital.
This is what you expect.
Somebody had their knee on the power.
This is what you expect in the United States is you pay out the ass for healthcare and you get absolutely nothing in return.
Mm-hmm.
It felt, it was not very reassuring. Yeah. Thankfully, our OB was great. She was
Your OB
incredible.
Was great. Dude, it was even funny. Like when I went to go visit him, I signed in. I literally was just like, yeah, my brother and his wife had a baby. And they're like, all right, go. And then I'm walking around the hospital. Like, I'm like.
Yeah, you're just kind of allowed in.
I'm like, really? Like, yeah. I can just walk in and like just start like fucking killing
Which
these babies.
Which is hilarious because when we showed up and Katie was in labor, they go, okay, why are you here? And they go, okay, go over there. And then another lady goes, okay, and why are you guys here?
Yeah.
And you were like, yeah, like Katie's hiding a beach ball yeah. under her shirt.
You can just
yeah.
walk in and be like, I'm here to look at pussies.
I like the screams. It really does it
I
for
like
me.
Watching giant ladies and their big pussies shoot out humans. I have no relation to the family.
I want to watch a pussy stretch. I want to see him stretch. No, dude, it was even funny. I accidentally went into the emergency room first, and I walked in. And I go, hi, I'm looking. My brother just had a, and then I see a guy like just burned to a crisp, like on a gurney. I go, oh my God. And I go, is this the word the baby? He goes, no. And then I'm holding your baby for the first
time. He cocks a shotgun and he goes, no. He puts it down like that yeah. cow in Napoleon Dynamite. Yeah.
He goes, you wanna He goes, if you walk in and you wanna, we'll let you do it. And dude, the first time I was holding your baby, I was just trying to push out like a fucking charred, crispy human like to the side of me.
This Eastern European nurse kept going in and she would look at the baby and she goes, oh my God, your baby is so cute. And then she goes, aren't mixed race babies just the cutest?
She really said that?
Swear to God.
Oh my God.
She said it so many times that on our way out, she remarked to all the nurses as we're going out the double swinging doors. She goes, everybody, that's the cutest baby I have seen all year. Aren't mixed race babies just the cutest babies?
Which
and then she tried to kill it on a rock. It's black and not the boy.
Quick, put it in the grocery bag. Do not let them see. Dude, which means, because they were both in the room, which means literally she was like doing all the stuff and like testing her. And then she's like, beautiful baby. And then she walks outside and she's like, you believe that wife fucked the shit out of a black guy and got her? That's what she has to think, right?
She thinks I'm like an assistant.
Like you're in some sort of weird, you've been cocked and cheated on, but
she
you decided
think you're
to raise
like
it.
The fourth Ball brother, like you're like LaMelo Ball Black or something. Why would she say that without that? Doesn't that come off as an insult?
I have no idea.
Like, are you saying my wife is fucking? Yeah. What do you think's going on here?
What?
I'm like, you go put him up, bitch.
Yeah, you put her against the fucking wall. Say it again.
I have a butterfly knife.
Literally,
doing it right by her ear.
What race would she think you are?
I don't know. Me and Katie still will never know.
Dude, if you would...
We'll never know.
Even if you were any other race, you would be Chinese. That's the only one you could possibly get
to. Well, the baby looks like an Asian baby of some kind, almost.
Yeah. It does,
She looks like a Blasian.
Which I'm thrilled about, because I saw the other babies in the hospital, and holy shit, we had the cutest one.
Yeah.
I'm not going to lie.
No, truly. I was a little worried, you know, because I don't like having to pretend babies are cute, but your babies are really cute.
Katie even said to you going in, she's like, yeah, no, babies are ugly for the first, like, 6 months. They're so ugly.
But luckily, she fucked a black guy.
I'm just saying, you know, when she gets that college scholarship, be thankful. Yeah.
Does she think I'm Jewish? Because she wouldn't say Jewish.
That's
right?
Not mixed race. You can't say.
I mean, Jews claim to not be white. We know this whole rigmarole.
Well, Jews right now really hate babies.
Yeah,
too.
True.
So yeah, I still don't know to this day what that means. I don't know if like a Lemon Party listener paid this woman an exorbitant amount of money to become our assigned nurse. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if she dressed up like how the Joker dressed up like the nurse and like walked in there and was she's like a paid actor from a Lemon Party fan to say that, but she kept saying it.
Mm-hmm. It's a beautiful mixed race baby. And you're obviously the father. You've announced you're the dad.
It seemed...
It's very obvious.
Actually, I did introduce myself as the father, because on the board, you have, like, the mother's name and the nurse and all that stuff. So she knew. And, like, I'm looking at my wife's pussy and her tits and stuff and her, like, her asshole. So she knows.
Maybe you're so tall, she's like, he must be mixed or something.
Like, he's so tall. She can only see shapes.
Yeah. He's so tall, the melanin got, like, stretched out.
Yeah.
And can't blacken him.
Because she was, like, what, like, Eastern European?
Like a Baltic thing.
Yeah,
I have no idea.
They have no concept. Like, they're the ultimate whites. Mm-hmm. So, like...
If somebody doesn't smell like onions, they think they're black.
You're wearing corduroy. Maybe it had to do with that. Yeah.
If you don't look like Rumpelstiltskin, you're a minority to them. Yeah, she's going back to making rock soup and spinning a blanket on a big wheel. A babushka.
Yes, I'll never know. Unfortunately, I'll never know.
That
is
so bizarre.
I guess Katie could be like a light-skinned Hispanic, maybe, but
not at all. No,
Katie's just white.
Yeah.
She's a lovely white woman.
You guys are a white-ass couple. Yeah.
But yeah, your kid does look like Pacific Islandy.
Yeah, it's great.
A little bit.
I love it.
It's great. It's also hilarious with your whole love of Lilo and Stitch, how she came out.
I know, it's
kind
great,
of
right?
It's kind of like oddly poetic.
I know, a little tropical baby.
Yeah, yeah.
A little Polynesian sauce on it.
Yeah. We were playing the Lilo and Stitch soundtrack as she came out.
Really?
Yeah, yeah.
That's great.
And as she's coming out, it's crazy because the lights in the room were like, they were becoming this extraordinarily bright. And like then when the baby's actually coming, like more nurses gathered in. So there's four women. And I kept looking at them and back to Katie. And it's like the moment. And I kept having this thought that these four women are angels. That's all I kept thinking about. I'm like, they're the incarnation of some, like they've been sent here from heaven and now they're bringing this thing from heaven. And when she came, I was like, oh, I could feel her like crossing over. Like, and there was a soul that was breathed into her. It was fucking insane.
Yeah.
It was the craziest moment of my life. And then doing skin to skin with her, and I got to cut the umbilical cord, and none of it was disgusting at all. I wanted to,
I wanted
to be in the juices and in the pussy and all of that. I thought I would think it's disgusting.
Yeah,
I'm like a faggot kind of.
You start fucking Katie right after. All the nurses, it's a completely horrific.
You go,
scene.
Doc, sew my dick into her new pussy.
Yeah, as I'm cutting the umbilical cord,
you're like a human centipede thing. Sew my dick inside her.
You're like, I've always wanted to fuck a pussy ass. I heard they tear into one hole. I want to fuck that.
It's like me cutting the vocal cord. I'm like, all right, can we get some privacy now? I'm about to fuck this shit out of my wife. Right here, yeah, right
you,
now.
You cut it with a big gold scissors like it's a Bucky's that you're doing a grand opening on.
Will and Don walk in.
Oh, we're here for the opening of Katie's pussy. Yeah, Don tries to eat the baby.
So did you have the moment where you have to, hit her on the back, make her cry?
No, she was
like
crying.
She's already crying.
She was beat the fuck up.
Yeah, she got the hell beat out of
her. She got beat the fuck up. Mm. By the way, they breathe through the umbilical cord.
Did you know that? So then when you cut the umbilical cord, do they go like...
I kept asking because like the pussy's stretching out like a rattlesnake's mouth, you know? And I'm like, is she okay in there like that? And they go, oh yeah, she breathes through the tube. And I was like, oh, okay. I had no idea.
Have you had the fear of like holding her wrong? Because I'm always terrified of babies and that soft head.
I pick her up like a kitten. I don't give a shit.
I go, come here.
Yeah,
you look at her.
You're holding stuff and you're pushing around with your feet around the apartment like an Amazon package.
I'll hold her. I'll putt. I'll like cook bacon. I don't care. I just want her always right here.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
She's great.
Beautiful, man.
Yeah. She's beautiful.
And the dogs
she's
have
funny too.
Yeah?
Yeah, she's funny as shit. Mm-hmm. She just makes these...
She's already the only funny woman you know. You had to grow the first funny woman in your life.
The only woman we know that loves fart jokes.
Oh, here's so easy the other thing I've mm-hmm. had to really, like reckon with. I came home...
Yourself?
Yes.
And all your beliefs.
I have no love for my dogs anymore whatsoever. Yeah. I do not give makes a sense. Shit about
pretty
them.
Pretty openly, yeah.
I don't care if they die. I'll torture them to death so one hair on her head is never harmed. Mm-hmm. I do not give a fuck about them. Gracie's been great because she'll just guard the baby. And I love her. I go, you serve the baby. And I'm trying to get Emma to do that too, but Emma's just mad that I don't give a shit about her anymore. But I don't care. I'm like, you can go drown in a pool or
right.
get swallowed by a, you know, a coyote. Like, live your whole Jonah and the whale story in the belly of a coyote. I don't give a shit.
Which is fuck shocking. Off. I literally thought you'd have to cut Gracie's neck with a knife, like, the first day.
Gracie's reacted well. Gracie's doing the whole, like, protective thing, putting her head on her and stuff. Mm-hmm. So Emma's acting out.
Yeah, Emma's acting out. Yeah. Gracie has a purpose, finally.
Well, Gracie's always been, like, kind of like a bitch lady who, like, needs to be busy to, like, not freak out. Mm-hmm. Like, right. That's Gracie. Yeah. But Emma is a little spoiled, little pigs. Mm. Yeah.
Well,
so.
You might have to kill one of them. What are you going to do?
Yeah. I mean, I don't really don't care if they die anymore.
Is that why you're watching the Chauvin documentary to learn how to do it? To do doggy MRT.
I didn't finish the Chauvin documentary, by the way.
Because you knew all the stuff already.
Yeah.
You're like, I should be directing this.
Did it turn off 8 minutes and 44 seconds in?
Apparently the actual time was like 9:30 or something. Mm. They came out later.
Oh, okay. Oh. So once again, know, we were lied to initially, by the lib so media.
I mean, that is the point of contention here is they kept saying 7:36 and it was changed to 8:36. Then people like Biden said like over 9 minutes.
He had 56 more seconds to figure out how to breathe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That black bastard.
I know.
I don't know. I don't know. I just remember seeing it, and I go, I don't really care what he's on. It looked like a death to me.
Yeah, it just seems a little weird. Yeah.
No, it's a bad look. It's a bad look, especially in this day and age. But this is a man was following protocol. Mm-hmm. He simply was being a police officer the way he was trained to be.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that was a lot of people's point, was that was the problem, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. But it kind of feels a little bit like
he was following police protocol, killing black people.
Well, mm-hmm. Okay. Well, here's the thing. Yeah. Here also is the thing.
Why do you think those targets at police ranges look like that? There's a reason
yeah,
for
that
it.
That is true. Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, everybody. Our first ad is for the Kadoo La La Land podcast. It's a fan of the show who messaged us. They do a podcast. They asked us to check out the Kadoo La La Land podcast. It is to pedophilia what Lemon Party is to racism. So what they do is every episode, we have it up there on the screen. You can go check it out. They review different videos of Lala Kadoo, who I believe is a Japanese porn star. On their Twitter, they say that Japan has an industry of making porn with women under 5 feet tall. Who pretend to be children. Let's talk about it. So go to their YouTube, check out their episodes. They've got a lot up there. I listened to a couple episodes talking about kind of a vague gray area child porn in the Japanese adult industry. You know, I love gooning. I know, Devin, you're a gooning man yourself.
Love the goon, yeah.
If you love gooning, if you love pornography, if you love this weird gray area of pornography, check out this podcast, the Kadoo La La Land podcast.
Wonder how they found Lemon Party.
This is live action Lolly that they're reviewing.
Basically, yeah. You could call it like a Lolly review podcast. Oh.
And it's basically in the name, La La Land.
Yeah, exactly.
Lolly Land.
Yeah, so go check them out, and we really thank them for sponsoring the podcast. This is their second ad they've done with us, so really appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks guys for supporting the show. This is their handle right here on YouTube.
Yeah, so go check them out.
The Kadoulala Land podcast.
So. All right. Thanks, and
God
back to
bless.
The show.
Thank you.
The cops did not stand with their own, and shame on them for not standing with their own.
I thought the cops did stand with their own.
No, they went on trial and they're like, this guy is insane. We don't train people to do this.
Oh, the police
they all,
chief.
Like all the chiefs and the cops, they all went up. They're like, this is crazy. We don't tell people to kneel on people's neck. They didn't, threw all of them.
It's a fiasco. So they
didn't want their house burned down.
Yeah.
So that's
yeah.
the thing. When there's that much public pressure, you don't get a fair trial, and that's yeah. what's fucked up about it.
Mm-hmm.
True.
So maybe they even raised his sentence even higher than they should have just to make the public happy. But fuck the public. Public doesn't know anything.
I mean, I remember even like the day of sentencing, I'm like, I want a guilty just so I can go to Buffalo Wild Wings later tonight.
Yeah, you don't want the Ralph's to burn down on your corner.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm.
Like, I got to get lemons and like chicken later.
It was really, we put Chauvin away for life because we were trying to preserve Valvoline's all across this nation. Okay, there's a lot of cheap mm-hmm. oil change places yeah. we can't afford to have burned down.
Yeah, mm-hmm. The AMPM monster was on the jury. The big Jamaican fruit
yeah,
guy.
Yeah, Chauvin tried to kill him too. You drink your soda hand.
Yeah, when they swore Chauvin and then he put his knee on the Bible. Yeah. Man. No, so I mean, yeah, I mean, he would, I don't know, it's just like, yeah, put him in jail. Who gives a shit? Just put him in jail, you know?
Yeah, but yeah, I guess you have to at some point, right? Thing. That is the thing, too. You got to give them something because they're going to kill everybody.
Yeah.
Don't you feel a little weird when a guy keeps yelling, I can't breathe for that long? Don't you let it off a little bit?
Yeah.
Even or if maybe, he is maybe kicking for, his legs.
Yeah, maybe for a second you're like, can you really not breathe?
No, and but then, like, I, yeah, right, like, isn't there listen, any I'm not humanity say, where you're like, falling. I think he might not be
listen,
able to breathe?
Ben, meet us halfway. I'm not saying no knee. Give you a little knee, you know? Just not 8.5 minutes.
I guess
minutes.
That is the Elie's Wiesel thing, right? Where it's like mm-hmm. people are just following protocol. Where mm-hmm. they go, well, this is what I'm supposed to do. This is MRT. Yeah. And that is the banality of evil. Is that the whole thing or something? That Jew said that once?
Yeah, that's Hannah Arendt, who okay. was a Jew.
Whatever.
Said that, the banality of evil, about Eichmann in Jerusalem.
Okay. Yeah. Who's the Elie Wiesel guy?
He wrote Night. And then Bernie Madoff stole all his money, so... It was, ironically, oh. Jews got him in the end.
Yeah.
Okay. His life was being pro-Jew, and then he got all his money taken by Jews.
He escaped prison, and lo and behold, he entered an even bigger one.
Yeah, exactly.
It's called Planet Earth.
Yeah, but don't worry. Joe Biden gave him $40 million.
Yeah. Take that cattle car right to bankruptcy.
So, yeah, I mean, I've spoke my piece now about Floyd. You know, I'm not the Floyd pill didn't go all the way down. I rejected it somewhat, but you know, it's good that I informed myself, I think, a little bit on this stuff. And you know,
listen, you can, I think the thing is you can dabble. Like, I think even during, you know, towards the end of the BLM riots, we were all like, all right, what's enough?
Oh yeah. I mean, it went far.
Yeah.
You know, and we had nothing to do.
That was more
had the pandemic not been going on, I don't know if that gets that much attention.
It was literally, I think, a lot of people needed to get outside, and the only thing that could do it was the idea of a black revolution.
Yeah.
All these gay white people to get outside again.
Yeah. Yeah. Which is ironic.
I remember, even not to turn this into a Camille show, but I remember the month before there was like big protests in Huntington Beach for COVID, and all my friends were like, that's sick. They're all getting COVID right now. And I remember during BLM, of course, we all turned into groundhogs. I went underground immediately, set up several periscopes to look through. But I would keep like kind of venturing my head out in different group chats I was in, because everybody was pretending they were, they were like, I think this is 100% great all the time. Mm. And then occasionally you dip your head, and I remember sending like a big thing of like fucking huge street in LA full of like 9,000 people neck to neck. And then I sent it to all those same friends, and they're like, no, they're all wearing masks. It's fine. They're outside. It doesn't matter.
Yeah,
at
it
all.
It was all extremely hypocritical.
Yeah. And that was that whole year was just different sides taking turns being gay about
it.
It is
ironic. A black guy inspired people to get out in nature. Everyone take a hike.
Yeah, that's true.
A black guy saved us from a Chinese virus, and isn't that a symbol for this country?
It is. Mm-hmm. Beautiful.
I think the thing I've been meditating on, like why I even watched it, is after having a kid, the thing I've been thinking about a lot is that a lot of this discourse in the world, it's like, you know, there's the way that the world is, and then there's the way that the world should be. And to only live in the way that you think the world should be is... it's kind of retarded and like pretty childish, and it's like, grow the fuck up. Mm-hmm. And like, maybe you should have to, you know, like fight for like love and light in this world. And that's a beautiful thing, actually.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But I think that
I don't know what
what the hell you're on about?
Yeah.
Do you have any idea how crazy you are?
Yeah. How fucked up you sound right now? Talking about Derek Chauvin. No, that's the thing. It's like, yeah, there's the way, the ideal way the world should be and the way the world is. But I think the people I always have problems with are the guys who are my bosses at security company jobs who, like, they don't view the world how it is because we're in Santa Clarita and everything's fine. And they're just being like, there's black people down there and they're robbing. Just getting furious at, like, the idea of black crime, which is happening, but it's not, you're fine. Like, why do you give a shit, you know?
Yeah, it is weird when your life is pretty good and you're still obsessed with finding these no pun intended, dark corners of the world.
Very good, Devin. Yeah, you join like this retarded Fox News army of like, here's what you get mad at today, you know?
Right.
You're like the Nightcrawler's victims.
Yeah. Well, it seems like racism is older people's like cardio. Like, like you kind of age into it. You're like, I don't really want to like work out. I'm just going to get really angry.
Because you start huffing and puffing.
Yeah.
Just in your chair. And they,
yeah.
That is Bowflex in the modern that's you turn on the news and you just see a black guy lifting a TV over his head and throwing it through the window of a jewelry store.
That's you doing a heavy cardio day is thinking about black people. And then your rest day, you're like, all right, I'm just going to think about Mexicans for a little bit. I'll get kind of upset at that.
Yeah, let's get onto the wall.
I had some videos I wanted to play, by the way.
Oh, yeah? That's,
like, what? Like, I was trying to figure out the context of this situation here.
Did you guys see this?
No.
This, these people at the airport. Is this going to play? Let me see.
Remember your girls.
Ah, it's damn.
Two gay guys.
You don't care about the girls? Shit. You don't care about the girls? You don't care about the girls? And they fucked the Cerberus. You don't care about the girls. Hello, everybody. Justin, American Airlines. Fuck the Cerberus. Here we go.
Is that a retarded gay guy?
Dude, I don't know if he's so drunk.
I can't tell if he's drunk, retarded, or gay.
I think the thing is, if he's sober, his gay accent's fucking insane.
Yeah.
And the fact that he's drunk, he sounds like he literally has Down syndrome.
Yeah, yeah. He's sober, you're right. He's like one of those gay guys that's like, meh.
Because isn't that the thing about being gay is it turns other gay guys on to sound like you've come in the jowls of your mouth.
Mm-hmm.
Like it's the Godfather. Like you put you soak cotton balls and cum and then put them back behind your molars.
They have all
molars.
Sorts of tricks. Cumming is never enough for them. He's so retarded. That's why he's gay. He doesn't know he's been fucking a man.
He doesn't know about pussy.
I think the title.
He thinks ass is pussy.
Yes,
he's like, man, I love fucking sweet ass pussy. Full of shit.
And they're both dressed like French mimes.
Oh yeah, these two.
What's the context?
It says airport travel is already bad enough without these two sashaying around.
Sashaying
around.
Yeah. So I want to tell you about
Shelby and Dolly. Shelby and Dolly. Shelby and Dolly. Remember,
I'm gonna do it for you.
Shelby and Dolly.
That's it.
This is just the new Will and Grace.
So he goes, keep thinking about your girls, Shelby and Dobby. Shelby and Dobby, keep think about your girls. Because I think they're probably traveling somewhere in the holidays to see, like, I'm assuming his nieces or something.
Right, oh, yeah.
Sure. There's one uncle they're going to go see that's, like, terrified of them.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah,
think
yeah.
about your girls. Or he had a beard and had kids.
Oh, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Or those are two, like, just, like, little midget people that he fucks. And he sees them on Christmas. Two little Thai children. He's trying to get on board to Thailand for a Bangkok Christmas.
Think about the Gwyns.
Think about your girls with their dicks taped into their butt cheeks to look like little women.
So yeah, they're
yeah.
There's no way this guy could have a beard, though, right?
Remember them.
I love how they chew themselves out in public. Because I think these people kind of picture that like this like they enter stage left, and they go it is the the faggot and retard show once again,
right,
and
no, it's, like
there was an
Costello.
Intermission, and now we're back.
Yeah, it's like an Andrew Lloyd Webber play.
the airport, fags yelling at the airport. And so now they're like, oh, I'm performing. Everything is so performative.
I love that, like, bloodhound just sitting there.
I know.
Oh, that bloodhound's going crazy inside. That's a well-trained dog.
I would. They do look like old-timey prisoners, too.
You know that dog just wants to do...
Wait for it to do, like, the Brad Pitt...
Yeah.
Whoa.
Yeah, start shoving it. Yeah. Whoa. Shoving a gay guy's head into the telephone.
The dog rips his pants down.
And gum fucks him.
Gum starts spilling out of his head.
Yeah, Leo shoves the flamethrower down his mouth and he sucks it off.
That is funny, like the dog biting his groin. And he's like, oh, yeah.
Oh, look at this big, strong black man.
The other guy's like, think about your girls. Shelby and Dobby. Shelby and Dobby.
Who I guarantee you are retarded and suck ass.
If you have a kid named Dobby, it better be retarded.
Dobby? Yeah. Good God.
If I had a retarded kid, I'd name her Dobby.
Yeah.
I'd change her name once I figured out she was fucked up.
That's what you name something you make out of, like, silly putty.
Yeah. God, thank God we don't have any gay psycho relatives who are going to, like, pretend that my daughter is their own and do horse shit like this around the holidays.
Yeah.
Well, once they saw how ethnic she looked, that won't be a problem.
No, not a problem at all.
They're sending you a letter disowning you right now. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mom did ask me to take his Christmas card back.
Okay, here's the end of it.
Look, I have most paper dogs. Fuck off, bitch.
What's so funny is he tries to have like a moment with her where he's like, look, I get it. I have service dogs. And she goes, go away, go away. And he goes, all right, you bitch. Starts going crazy. They're so bipolar.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, in this guy's head, he thinks he's like in RuPaul's Drag Race. When gay guys get drunk, that's what they go to. He thinks he's doing like this type of shit.
Yeah, right.
But he's too retarded.
By the way, gay people stole everything from black women.
Exactly.
Okay, their whole personalities are just sassy black women.
Mm-hmm.
But also, why would he have service dogs? Like, what is that? Like, Rufus, bring me my prep.
The dog stops people from fucking his ass. The dog just puts a paw over his ass.
He's got two Dobermans that just sit out behind his ass.
Like he's
all night.
About to have a seizure if he bends his asshole out. The dog just covers it so he doesn't hurt himself.
Why don't gay guys copy black guys? Why just black women? Mm-hmm. What is that? Why don't they copy like a black guy, like walk
if
around?
If they copy black guys, they'd kill themselves. Black guys do not like gay people.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Holy shit.
But that's why they do they're black women. Mm-hmm. They're just very like, honey, okay.
Sassy.
You know, they're like this close to saying like, sugar child.
I guess that's the funny thing about this archetype of gay guy is like, to be that person, you need like some sort of like social grace and like, you need to be like suave.
Mm-hmm.
Like you need to have a razor sharp knife to be making those cuts and like in discussions and stuff to be like, ooh, ooh, here or there. But if you're like sloppy and sound retarded.
I've met a couple gay people.
Then it's crazy.
Yeah, I met a couple gay people who thought they were like Sasha Fierce, but they're not intelligent. So they just go like, oh, honey, you look like a fat faggot. And they're just mean. They're mean as fuck.
Yeah, they're so mean and retarded.
Mm-hmm. They're like, your pussy stinks. You gross bitch. I hate you.
And they all die like easy.
I don't even know how great like Oscar Wilde was at that stuff, by the way, because you know they say like, or I'm sorry, Orson Welles.
Orson Welles wasn't gay.
No, I know, but like Orson Welles was like quippy and like really had like amazing comebacks supposedly. Mm-hmm. And then I watched like a compilation the other day, and he's on Johnny Carson.
Yeah.
And this guy is a guest.
The guy from Beretta, right?
Yeah. And he says Orson, you've gained a lot of weight, and he goes, I can always lose weight, but you'll always be ugly.
Mm-hmm.
And the crowd's like, oh, and Johnny's like,
yeah.
And I'm like, he didn't even say it quick, and it's not really that well worded.
Right.
But people are like, he was a legend.
Yeah, people are like, he wore a robe and he was really fat.
But he's just fat. That's why people think it's like a cool, quippy. You just turn to the guy, he's like, yeah, you're dead.
Mm-hmm.
He turned back.
Dude, there's an interview I read last year of they never published it, but it was, they taped Orson Welles, and this guy's just like, what do you think about Clark Gable? And he goes, Clark Gable's a fucking faggot. He sucks. His movies suck. He was a real hater. I do love that about
him. There never was. I think there's this idea. It's a myth that there ever was a guy who was like that quick and like bing, bang, boom. And mm-hmm. I think probably the closest really was just Jackie Gleason.
Right.
Rickles.
Gleason. Jackie Gleason and Rickles. And then like that's literally but the Rickles only two even, guys were cut from that cloth.
But Rickles even would do a lot of jokes where he's like, oh, bend over and fire a rocket. And you're like, what is that?
He says a lot of things so quick. You're like, I don't even know what that meant. But the crowd just laughing because of like the rhythm, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Also, being a quippy guy sucks. I hate that style of humor for the most part.
I hate clever.
Yeah.
I hate clever anything.
Yeah. Like watching the movie Fletch, that drives me fucking crazy.
We were talking about that, me and you on Christmas. I hate Fletch. I don't get it. I
hate Fletch.
I think Chevy Chase sucks ass.
Dude.
I've never understood him.
National Lampoon was on, the Christmas Vacation was on in the hospital, and I was like, this sucks my ass.
I don't get it. I know a lot of people love him, so I'm going to get some.
He's not good.
And most of his humor, most of his humor in movies was him going like, doctor, 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 doctor. And it's like, you're like a Zooey Deschanel guy. Like, you think you're quirky and twee, you know?
Yeah.
Like, if he was a girl, he'd be going like, whoop, whoop.
Yeah.
Like that.
Like, if he's so funny, like, he's literally the ninth funniest guy in Caddyshack.
Yeah.
Like, I put everybody else.
The gopher
is
better than him in the movie.
Yeah, the gopher gets more laughs than him. What does he do? He sucks vodka off of a woman's, like, pussy?
Yeah.
That's kind of it.
No, it's Christmas Vacation. He jumps in a pool and he goes, oh, it's cold, cold. And he starts yelling. And
you're like, dude, that's the whole thing.
That's the whole thing.
And then, like, in Christmas Vacation, he's, like, eating the Thanksgiving, or he's eating the turkey, but it's, like, burnt. And he's like,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm like, that's it?
Yeah.
That's all you got?
Meanwhile, Randy Quaid, who is a comedic genius,
killing it,
is in a Santa hat shitting in his open sewer. You're like, this is the greatest comedy I've ever seen.
He carries those movies, actually.
He really does.
He's fantastic in them.
It's one of my favorite things, Vegas Vacation, where he's like, I'll get the babysitter, and he overturns a box full of snakes, and just the kids start picking up the snakes and wrestling them.
I mean, Randy Quaid's amazing at like Kingpin and shit.
He's amazing in his own sex tapes. He's funny.
He's amazing in life right now as he drives a Volkswagen with his wife, and they think they're escaping the mafia. At this moment, they're literally on Route 66.
Yeah, fucking his wife in like a Rudy Giuliani mask or whatever. What did he fucked her in like a weird mask, right?
He put on a mask of like Don Lemon or something and fucked her. Jesus. Some guy, maybe Wolf Blitzer? Was it a Wolf Blitzer mask? He was like, hey, CNN. Like,
his wife was like, you're not white enough. Put on this Don Lemon mask.
I'm Don Lemon. And I definitely say it when I'm not on air.
I guess if we got the funding... I think the biggest get we could get if we had the funding to make a Lemon Party movie, he could be the star of it.
Quaid?
He would say yes.
Yeah.
Randy's phenomenal.
We just have to tell him, like, we're not accessible to that Hollywood bullshit.
Right.
You and your wife are safe.
Yeah.
Okay. We'll bodyguards.
We'll tell him we're making a movie with the Daily Wire and he'll sign right up.
Yeah.
Does he think he's on the run from the devil or
he
something?
He thinks he's on the run from an elite group of Hollywood hitmen. Mm-hmm. For years, he's been on the run.
Because of information he has?
He just thinks him and his wife are being targeted. And that they're being tracked.
So is she just enabling him? She doesn't think any. But this is like her meal ticket.
I think she might just be like a big Mountain Dew with eyes. Like, I don't really know if we're talking about like a normal woman.
Yeah, yeah. There is like, there in life, like a man with schizophrenia finds a Cookie Monster sweatpants woman, and they live a beautiful life until they kill each other.
Yes,
in a Motel A.
It's a beautiful tale.
It's a beautiful, but it's a beautiful 7 years full of wild sex and Don Lemon mess.
Yeah, on second thought, if you rewatch the videos, it looks like she's made of popsicle sticks or something. It's just Google eyes and popsicle.
She's a
sticks.
Human birdhouse.
Yeah,
yeah.
He's dating the AMPM man,
the mascot.
The mascot, yeah.
Anyway, I love Randy Quaid though.
Yeah, you know these gay people. By the way, they were stewardess on the flight after this video. And then, I always get gay. Why are there gay stewards all the time?
Well, I think
is it so they can fly places and fuck.
I think so. Yeah,
nasty
I think
sets?
So. Yeah, they're very like devious. You know, behind closed doors relationships. And I think being a flight attendant started. You know, a lot of like in the old days. Like I honestly think there was a lot that just fucked you. Like it was all you were almost a prostitute in the old days, like if a Pan Am flight attendant or a stewardess. There was a weird like you watch old movies and you see the old commercials and they make a lot of sexual like wink wink.
They had the references. Short skirts. There probably was like a Don Draper guy getting sucked off
in
on
fact,
a Pan Am flight.
I think a couple airlines back in the day had like Mile High like in their advertisement
really?
With like a woman like wink wink like.
Ooh.
So, and then so the gay guys get in on that, you know?
Mm-hmm. Your W-2 back then said sex trafficking victim.
Yeah. I think your ass opens up too with that altitude.
Mm-hmm.
It's like natural poppers. Just take me to the moon.
But there's some the guys on planes are really gay too. I've seen guys like shutting the overhead thing by like throwing their ass out, like shutting it.
Especially Southwest.
Southwest
a lot of gay flight
Southwest
attendants.
Southwest is either gay flight attendants or our moms who will get blackout drunk and fuck you and think you raped them. That type of energy.
That's so specific.
But I think I'm right. But you know what? I'm going to double down on this. I think I'm right.
It's just funny. It all sounded like it was from personal experience.
I know. Those whores. Fuck them.
It is always a woman that like comes over the intercom. She's like, all right, I've had two Irish coffees. Who's going to rape me? And then anybody got dibs?
It's just a bunch of maniacs out of the flight attendants. And then the pilot's name is like Dallas Fort Worth. And he's like this ultimate Texan man.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I've had Southwest flights where they get on, yeah, like literally like kind of hammered, and they're like, all right, we're doing free drinks for the cabin because it's Tuesday.
Yeah.
You're like, God damn. You just get fucking railed in hotel rooms across this country.
Mm-hmm.
No, this is every flight attendant I've had on Southwest. Is this guy right here.
This guy.
Yeah. Have you guys seen this clip?
Yeah, is this a real person?
I looked it up. It's an HBO special, apparently.
That's an HBO
Wait,
special?
Wait, but this is a late night set, this looks like.
Well, this person has an HBO
has
special.
Okay.
I forget their. Oh yeah, Leo Reich is his name. Is the guy's name?
All right.
Or the they's name?
Mm-hmm.
It's this. I mean, I'm only gonna play 1 second of it.
I'm Leo. A bit about me. I'm a comedian. Yuck.
That's all I watched.
Mm-hmm.
I usually make it about 4
You know what's
seconds.
Funny though is he's trying to now do the anti-comedy thing. He's trying to make fun of.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's disgusting how he's standing on stage with a microphone.
He's on stage. Yeah.
Yeah, even though he's dressed like Howie Mandel in 1986. Like, he might as well put a fucking rubber glove on his cock and blow it up.
Mm. So, what late night show is this that he's on here?
Oh, shit. I mean, I can usually tell by the fake laugh. Let me see. Let me see if there's a fake laugh in the background.
Is this Seth Meyers' show?
I'm also queer.
Yeah, it might be.
That, I watched
Thank
the whole thing. That's the
home,
only
that's shock
response
sound.
He gets. That's the only big response. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because they're being cattle prodded under their seats. It's like the Bugs Life ride at Universal Studios. They start sending like airwaves at you.
Look into Leo Reich.
Well, the HBO website, the HBO special. Well, it's called Literally Who Cares, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then the description of it is amazing because it says. Well, here it is.
His special is called Literally Who Cares.
Literally Who Cares? Mm-hmm. I'm queer. Clap.
Oh, here we go. Yeah. I think one of them said it was like devoid of humor, like which is like a good thing.
And they're like, good. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
He's asking the big questions. Is this helping? Am I hot? And no offense, guys, but literally, what is going on? Leo Reich, Literally Who Cares, blends songs, anecdotes, and anxious non sequiturs in a valiant attempt to raise awareness. By the way, he blends songs, anecdotes, and anxious non sequiturs. So do like homeless guys on the subway.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Give them HBO spot.
Like, listen, there right now, there's 7 black teenagers on the F train jumping over their entire family. They have so much more talent than almost anyone that's given anything.
Mm.
I mean, he looks like one of Hannah Gadsby's shits.
Someone's a turd burglar at a. Oh, that's great. Oh yeah, here it is. Look, read it. I'm not bullshitting. This is real.
Leo Reich, Literally Who Cares, comedian/writer Leo Reich treads the line between the hilarious stand-up and humorless performance art in his first HBO comedy.
It's
special.
A new thing they're calling humorless performance art.
Mm.
Instead of stand-up, this is what they think people want because it's they think they're going to find another Gatsby. That's what they're hoping for.
Right, right.
Yeah. Well, I mean, they can't write jokes, so they've just given up on it, effectively.
I mean, thank God. Mm-hmm. I love that this keeps happening, you know? Keep listening to Lemon Party.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, keep doing your humorless horse shit. God bless you.
Are you really going to have the name Leo Reich?
Yeah. Well, he's probably like Mengele's grandson.
Yeah,
or
that's
something.
What I was thinking, too.
That's why he's on late night. I'm sure Henry Kissinger's great grandson out there is getting fucked in a warehouse party in Brooklyn right now.
For sure.
going from his writing job at like fucking John Oliver's show,
yeah. Dating Osama bin Laden, his like nephew.
They're shoving fucking rockets up each other's asses. That's a sick. It's a sick world.
Yeah. I mean, it's very funny. Like, it's hilarious how antiquated that already is. Like, we've been so upset at this for 5 years. Yeah. I'm like, that's so, you're so old. Mm-hmm.
I was going to say, this feels like when you heard comics talk about 1991. Like, the fucking just roof has, like, caved in on everything.
This is the new, like, you know, airplane food.
Yeah. And all of them. I mean, yeah, you know, like, fucking Brio Posehn, I think I saw him panhandling on the 405 the other day. These people are, like, almost homeless at this point. Paul F. Tompkins is sewing his own Monopoly Man suits.
Yeah.
Out of old carpets.
Yeah. They work at, like, Hot Dog on a Stick. You go to the mall. Go to Build-A-Bear. Yeah.
Yeah. Rest in peace.
It's so funny. Ben pulls up the clip. He plays 3 seconds of it and then moves right on.
That's all I'm willing to play. This is a perfect video for me.
This one's great. Can you put that on the screen real quick?
This Ben? One's 11 seconds. That's what I'm looking for.
I like this.
Yeah. I can't watch.
Oh, this is that barber shit. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Is it okay if I touch it? Yeah. Okay.
Okay, so let's pause 2 seconds in. She asked for consent to touch her hair. She's a barber. She's sitting in a barber chair.
Yeah, at a barber shop that she walked into and gave her money.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like your mechanic being like, can I work on your car?
Yeah? Okay, cool. And what are your pronouns? They, them.
She just chops her head off like Sweeney Todd.
I'm glad that you came in today.
Yeah, you missed. She was she, her. That was her. Yeah. She, they. That was her pronouns.
She, they.
Which I always love the she, they. It's like, you can call me a woman, but I like to be annoying a little bit. I like to be annoying for no reason, but, you know, if you, you know, I still take money from my parents, so. I'm a she, they. Yeah. And this woman is just like, I love this person who's just like, they've lost their entire 20s to, like, just nerding out for fucking being fake autistic, fake trans. Fake
I mean,
gay.
They really do want to be, like, treated like animals. She has a leash around her neck.
Yeah. Dude, she wants her head shaved like an Auschwitz victim.
It's unbelievable. They buy their clothes at Petco.
Yeah, some spooky cat from Halloween Town or something.
No, literally, like, the personality of, like, when you go to cat sit for somebody and you open the door and it runs into the other room and just shakes. It's that in a human.
Yep. Yep. I don't know what happened, but, yeah, humans at some point just wanted to, they started wanting to, like, live their life like wet animals.
Yeah. I guarantee you 10 years from now, that entire generation will look back, like, people in the 70s who got really into disco and did cocaine too much.
Yeah.
And they're like, yeah, that kind of, like, ruined my life.
I fully agree with that.
The amount of people who have autism now has driven me crazy. Mm-hmm. These fake autism diagnoses.
Oh, I know. Oh, it's hip to be a retard now. Yeah.
It is hip to be
a
retard.
Literally, it's like it's wigger retards.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Riggers.
Yeah. I can't wait for white women to start identifying as having Down syndrome. They're having to do the voice.
My pronouns. Oh, man. And then this is, who's this type of lady? The barber. Like, what is this?
Well, this is the thing where they dress up like Bob the Builder or some shit. I was like, oh, I only feel safe if Caillou's cutting my hair. These fucking freaks. I did a deep dive on her TikTok just to see what was up.
When you're so non-binary, you become Steve from Blue's Clues.
Yeah. Every video is the most smug fucking thing I've seen on her TikTok. Because I'm up at all hours of the night now with the baby. So, like, you know, I'm either reading or I need to find things to, you know, fuel me, to keep me going.
It's amazing that you're writing and reading, and in between that I'm getting sent the worst videos of all time.
You're retarded.
Oh, and I'm still writing more than ever.
No, that's what I'm saying. Is you'll tell me, you'll, like, text me, like, I read 30 pages today, and I text my text like, 6 a.m., fat retarded guy eats own dick. A gay woman plucks her eyes out, tries to give it to a black man she sees.
No, I never stop.
But in between writing, you do need to forage. Yeah. So this is retard foraging.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
Henry David Thoreau going through the woods, like, eating retard berries.
This is Ben's version of, like, Oscar Wilde writing a great novel and then going and doing opium to get through the day.
Every fucking video is so smug, where she's filming herself sitting down in her barber chair.
Yeah.
In her different Richard Scarry outfit for the day. And she just goes,
That feeling when the trolls are very triggered that you have the only genderqueer barber salon in all of Omaha, Nebraska.
Yeah.
Oh,
you know what? Yeah. You know what I want? You know what? I want to like have like push a Palestinian child in front of you and have you explain your life to them mm-hmm. while they look at you.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, like, I've been receiving bombardment as well in the comment section. They go, young one.
And they go, I've been eating rocks for 20 days. He goes, well, that's.
She goes, that's because Hamas is your culture.
Yeah, that's your culture. He goes, I want to kill you.
She goes, that's what I thought.
Please.
Because that's what all of you need to be killed. Because of
little baby is like, I want to chop your teeth off and play hacky sack with it.
Yeah. Little Palestinian baby being like, why do you create these insane rules for everyone? Do you like it? You've used the same basic tools of enslavement that exist in the culture, but you've perverted them to your own sick desires.
You know what's
desires?
Bullshit, too? She dates a hot, she's married to a hot lady.
Mm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which is fucking bullshit when mm-hmm. they both do it.
It's like, good.
They're both locking their pussy up.
Keep ruining your lives, retards.
Mm-hmm.
You'll look back one day and go, oh, was I young? Oh, I guess I wasted my whole youth.
Yeah, I wasted my whole youth playing a game of Uno I created in real life.
I wasted my youth dressing like a lumberjack and not fucking.
Yeah. And then also, like I am saying, like literally taking like the things that... like in society that hurt people, like you've just taken them and then you've made yourself the king of that system. It's the exact same thing.
Mm-hmm.
Rules, separating, shaming. It's the exact same tools that you were yourself railing against.
You're a CEO of fake oppression, basically.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway, before we start the pod, we always swear in on the Anthony Comedia book.
Put your hand up. Well, just looking at the table of contents real quick, because we should close today's show with maybe a passage, but...
A passage from the Book of Camilla.
When did he write? Did he write this before or after him and Opie
That's
fully
what I'm
hated
kind of
each
wondering.
Other?
By the way, someone kept tagging me on Twitter that like Opie was like screaming. He was like drowning in the ocean, like going live.
Really? Yeah, Opie's live streaming like, from a whale's belly.
Yeah, he's standing like the tide is rising and like it's taking him out to sea.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, yeah, you know, dude. I mean, it's like, you the know, me and Bill Burr are tight. It's fine.
Bill
you
Burr's,
know, he's going to do his thing.
Bill Burr's wife's a black whore. I mean, what's the deal with Tic Tacs? I like the orange, but people pull out the green.
Why does he talk? He it's like how a newborn doesn't have like neck muscles mm-hmm. yet, and so his head's just constantly.
Right. Well, when you have nothing entertaining to see, he's like moved to like sensory like overload. Mm-hmm. He's like, if I move like jingle my keys, that'll be like content.
I'll pull it up real quick. Someone was tagged, and I appreciate everybody tagging me.
I do love that. There's like 10 people in their 50s who are always wondering why we're getting tagged and all their tweets.
Literally look at his head. Look at his head. He's literally doing it. Look. Look right here. Here we go. It's amazing. It's literally.
Hey, what's going on, everybody? Like, welcome to my little live stream.
That's his intro.
At the ocean, last day of 2020.
So he's going like, like he has to pretend he has a band. He can't just play a. He can't just play a, like a little tune on a thing.
Dude, it's like an 8-year-old making their own show in their room. Man, welcome back to the Tonight Show, starring Lita Opie.
2023. What's going on, man? Who do we got? We got Stephen Godley, icon. Damn, that sounds impressive.
So he knows each single person
all the
watching.
Way down there in mm-hmm. South Africa. What's For up, sure. Minash? How are you? Nick Umrick.
Yeah. I mean, this might as well be a FaceTime call, really.
What is he talking about like halfway through?
Yeah, you go 40 minutes and he's just like, so maybe I'll take my own life. Who knows? What do I have to live for?
I mean, it doesn't even load. Because, he, of course, he does it on the Twitter live thing, which doesn't fucking work.
You know, people see him live streaming on the street in New York and start like handing him change and coins.
100%. 100%. I bet he drowned in a rainstorm earlier that day.
Well, I was trying to see. I don't know when this was written because I wanted to see if there was like anything, like any chapters that were questionable. But.
I think he was still on radio when this was written. I'm not sure. No, it was after because he's behind the prison bars.
This was about him coming into his own on the Opie and Anthony show.
This is the only book that isn't banned in Florida libraries. Kids go to the library, they just have the Kamiya book and Too Fat to Fish.
I want to read like a... none of this is going to be what I think it is, actually, I think.
Did you already say the foreword is the N-word?
Yeah. The only book with a foreword and N-word. Very good.
Very, very good. Well, I guess we'll just end with...
what is the last...
By the way, this is the title of the book I'm working on.
Permanently
suspended. The Rise and Fall and Rise Again of Radio's Most Notorious Shock Jock. Yeah.
I love that every comedian's book has to be 85 words long because their fans are mentally retarded. You have to be like, The Rise and Fall, America's Biggest Shock Jock. They think they buy the book, read the title, and then put it away. They think they read the whole book.
Yeah, and they always go, he's actually a really great writer. I'm like, they hired the most retarded two ghostwriters in the world to write this.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
It's never, if you read these things, it's never in their voice.
It's like
anything.
Mongo the Trucker was putting this together over the last 20 years. And you know, yeah. Anthony like really didn't want to put it out because he hates the color of the ink.
Yeah, it took him years to write it because he kept doing white ink on white paper. Like, Anthony, we don't know what it says.
Yeah, this is just like a historical thing, I guess. I thought it would be like maybe his takes. Oh, well, here we go. Here we go. Page 128. I got the N-word and not the word Nazi.
Really?
Yeah. One of our funniest bits was with the comedian Patrice O'Neill. We called it N... You see here, it's hard R.
Yeah.
I'm not going to say it. We'll get banned on YouTube.
N-word versus Nazi.
During this time period, the actor Danny Glover had made his plight known publicly that he couldn't get a cab in New York City because he was African-American. Okay, so this book does get good.
Oh, this was a great bit.
Patrice was on the show, and we were talking about it. And he said, yeah, nobody wants to pick up a boop. He says, Patrice is hard R. Mm-hmm. I was like, hey, I have a Nazi helmet. I'll put it on. Why does Ant have a Nazi helmet?
Well, you know why Ant has a Nazi helmet.
He has a birthday once a year.
Yeah.
I'm kind of like putting everything together.
Yeah, why do people who work at In-N-Out have In-N-Out shirts?
He goes, hey, I have a Nazi helmet. I'll put it on and you stand upstream from me. We'll both try to hail a cab to see if the cab driver picks up an N-word or a Nazi.
I think I do remember this.
Yeah, this is great.
Yeah.
That's hilarious.
Anthony got a cab before Patrice.
Yeah, Patrice stopped me because the first cab blatantly passed by Patrice and stopped for me. Patrice screamed, Nazi, Nazi, you pick up a Nazi over a boop, you motherfucker. You didn't stop for a boop. You picked up a goddamn Nazi over a boop. You chose a Nazi, brother. The second cab stopped for Patrice. The third cab hedged its bets and went between us.
Yeah, that's
the next one went for the Nazi. Patrice said, I'm going to pull this out for the boops. Then Patrice tied it up and was going to game 7. The deciding cab passed right by Patrice and stopped in front of me. I thanked him for picking a Nazi over an African-American. The Nazis won. Crazy shit. Yeah, there's literally a picture of him wearing a Nazi helmet with Patrice.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That's a classic pick.
God, they're look at them. Mm-hmm. What a beautiful duo.
What a great time.
What a
dude.
Beautiful
duo. You know Jim Norton married a trans person?
Yeah, Jim's fully gay.
Yeah. It's nice to see him finally come out, but like, God, when I saw that, I was like, God, I can't believe ONA isn't around for that episode when he came
when
on.
When he marries a trans person.
Oh,
yeah.
My God.
I wonder what Opie has to say about it.
Opie was trying to break into the ceremony. They had sheriffs stopping him.
Oh, that's fucking great. Yeah.
And as we always say, we love Ant. We think he's one of the funniest people
ever.
You kidding
me? He's the best.
Yeah,
he's the fucking best.
Yeah, your morals and your racial beliefs and gross things like that doesn't take away from how fucking incredibly funny he is. He's funnier than almost everybody. Yeah. So.
Dude, I would if Hitler had good paintings, I would look at them. I don't care. I'll separate any art from any artist.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I'm trying to think if, you know, I wonder if people are upset I talked about my baby and got gay, but whatever.
I don't think. I don't think people.
This is the only time they're going to hear a father talk about
their
child.
You're allowed to be a
love.
Human. And also, we didn't really like let you have that many moments. We make a bunch of psycho jokes. Mm-hmm. So
it's true.
Yeah, most of it was calling your baby black.
Yeah.
So, yeah. I said you Derek Chauvin your baby to change your diapers. So.
In order, we watched Lilo and Stitch. Then we watched The Whale. Then we watched It's a Wonderful Life. And then we watched the George Floyd documentary. Mm. So that's the quaternity.
That's what you call one for her, one for me. That's how you watch stuff. Yeah.
Kept training.
Mm-hmm.
And that was crazy.
You're like, here's Blue's Clues, now Gavin McGinnis. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
She's eating like the whale. It's crazy. Mm. She eats so much. It's insane. She's eating way more than she should be, but she's not vomiting. She's just shitting like crazy.
Yeah. She's a shin baby.
She binge eats and then just blow, and her diaper blows out. Yeah. And but she doesn't stop.
She blows it out like a cartoon. Like there's a big, it's all unfolded.
Yeah. There's smoke coming out of it.
All burnt.
I don't, this is the other thing too. I don't know how to say this without sounding like a pedophile, but I love changing her diaper. I love changing my daughter's diaper.
I don't. You're a sick.
It's your daughter and all that. But yeah, I mean, there's a lot I could say.
I love it. I love every second of it.
You love shit and you love kids.
Mm-hmm. It is funny too, because I'm surrounded. Like
you told me that's the only part you do like. Is changing
yeah, that's the
diaper.
Only thing. I don't hold her. I don't sing to her. I just go, as soon as you smell, as soon as you smell something's up, hand her to me.
Yeah.
Then it's daddy's turn.
Isn't it crazy? I know we're trying to, but isn't it crazy? Isn't it crazy that like literally not even 30 years ago, you would like go through this and then you would see the baby when it's like 17. You'd be like, all right, I'll see you later. And then you would have nothing to do with the baby's life.
Yeah. That's the thing too. I've lost empathy for like people who don't like walk, for people who walk out on their kids baby. And stuff. Like, how do you look at your kid and you don't give a shit?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah. It's very strange.
I think there's something like pre-1990, like 60% of like dads didn't change one diaper in their entire life. Like multiple kids.
It's such a blessing.
Yeah. So.
But it's weird because my refrigerator is now just filled with breast milk and there's diapers everywhere.
Hey.
So if I was a detective and I walked in, I'd be like, what kind of sick fuck do we have here? I mean, literally be like the sketch.
Yeah. Yeah.
But that's a new merch drop.
The newborn sketch that we did. What's funny too is like when Katie's like, changing like the baby's diaper and stuff or whatever, she'll just start doing Joey's voice.
Yeah, I guess the mother load.
Yeah, yeah. She'll literally say, "Holy fucking shit! This is the mother load."
Yeah, I can't wait for your daughter to run. Like we see her at Christmas and she runs into my arms and goes, "Did Derek Chauvin killed himself?"
I'm gonna have to answer the big questions. She's gonna be asking me, and I gotta, you know, guide her the right way.
Where you go, she goes, "Daddy, which race commits the most crimes?"
tugging on my little coat
you're
sleeve.
Going, well, come here. Yeah, you're dressed like Ward from Leave It to Beaver, big pipe and a smoking jacket. Well, sit on my knee, little girl, and I'll tell you.
I can't wait to have those moments with her.
Daddy said it was protocol.
And MRT, he was trained.
Typical cop protocol.
Well, she's like Rain Man, where she's like in kindergarten. She's like, 11 nanograms of fentanyl. 11 nanograms of fentanyl. 11 nanograms of fentanyl.
Big knee, kill black man.
Yeah, she gets fucking sent to the principal's office for having the protocols of the Elders of Zion. She's reading the protocols of the Elders of Zion behind her textbook like it's a comic book.
It's crazy because I could fuck her up real bad, right?
Yeah.
I could teach her about like Yakub and be like, that's God. And it would really actually destroy her. I could tell her aliens are real. And that night they come in the house and they just masturbate and like pee everywhere and stuff. I could tell her crazy shit. And she would just think it's real.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because she's a fucking retard.
Yeah. You could tell her if she smiles, her head will explode. She just has to live like that.
What's crazy in the first week is she copies your facial expressions. So I raise her to my face and I smile and then sometimes she'll start trying to copy. So they just copy whatever you do.
Right.
They're learning.
So you have a lot to change.
I have a lot to change, my friend. I have a lot to change.
Well, you know, I got a lot to change. Got a lot to change. Got a kid on the way. I'm going to raise her in this tall grass. You know, Norton likes it a little funny. I live in a marsh.
Where is this? I feel like he broke into somebody's house and he's just on their deck.
This is a wildlife reserve. Dude, there's like helicopters shooting beams on him right now.
Yeah, it's like adaptation.
Yeah. He might live in eternal sunshine of the spotless mind. He's gone inside his own head and just watches Jim and Ann run away from him in his memories.
God. All right. Well, we need to go and then record another episode.
Okay.
I'm fucking real tired. I need to get another coffee at Starbucks.
All right. Bye.
Happy New Year, folks. God bless.
Bye, everybody. God bless. Happy New Year.
What the fuck is this piece of shit?
West Texas town of El Paso, I fell in love with a Mexican girl. Nighttime would find me in Rose's Cantina, music would play and Felina would whirl. Blacker than night were the eyes of Felina, wicked and evil while casting a spell. My love was deep for this Mexican maid, I was in love but in vain I could tell. One night a wild young cowboy